Hey, this is Jared Cochran with Family Church. Welcome to our podcast. I'm excited that you're here. I hope that God moves through this message to reach you so he can move through your life. Be sure to share and subscribe so that we can reach the world with God's word. Enjoy the message. Welcome back to another wonderful Wednesday on The Family Room. I have my beautiful wife, Kelsey, here.
I hate when you do that.
Why?
I don't know.
You hate love and adoration?
No.
No.
Let us know where you're watching from, unless you're in the Atlantic.
Unless your name is Philip.
We hope the boat sinks. Not really. That was
a
little.
Oh, my God.
No, I'm just kidding.
He's just kidding.
Let us know where you're watching from. Oh, that reminds me of that one comment one time when I said, I'm just kidding, and somebody turned it off because they said they won't listen to a pastor that lies, because apparently you just don't understand sarcasm.
I missed that one.
Which, geez, it was a long,
or
long time ago.
Or it could be the Christmas one that I made where I accidentally said that long post.
Oh, I forgot about that one.
Last Christmas, I wrote a really nice Christmas post and talking about, you know, slew a slide during the holidays. Well, I didn't want to say the word.
Oh my gosh.
You know what I mean? During the holidays. And it was, I meant to say, you are not alone. And I posted it and I had actually said,
you are alone.
And I haven't lived that one down ever since.
So
good times.
Great times.
Okay, so.
You doing the announcements?
I was trying to.
Oh.
Okay.
Excuse me. I'll just get up and leave.
So, anyway, so Dining with Dignity is tomorrow night from 5:30 till 6:30. And then we have a somewhat normal Sunday this Sunday with lots of clapping.
Somewhat normal.
Yeah, because every Sunday after this Sunday, there's something going on.
That was confusing.
Women's Fellowship is next Thursday, 6:30 to 7:30. Have you heard from Lauren about who's...
No, I don't think I have. I know that she had talked to me... sometime last month about having something planned that sounded fun and all Christmassy, but I don't think I know who the leader was yet. And if I do, then I've forgotten, and it's in my email somewhere, so that's
Jeez
on me,
Louise.
If it is. But yeah, it should
email
be good.
Me.
yeah.
okay, and then the 15th is the Ugly Christmas Sweater Day, which I'm just ordered a new one, and you're going to preach
it. I'm hoping it's coming soon.
Mine's better than yours.
I don't know.
No, it is. And then Fire Youth is doing their Christmas movie night on the 15th at 6 o'clock. And then we have the chili cook-off at the end of the month. Forgot what I was going to say. Oh, so Rock the Universe is coming up in January for the youth.
Yes.
And we are trying to come...
completely sponsor them.
Yes, except for a $50 deposit on the youth side. But we're trying to get the tickets. We have transportation, fuel, dinner, snacks, all of that will be provided. And if anyone is interested, I know it's around the holidays, so obviously we're all trying to save money for kids' Christmas presents and stuff. If anyone wants to sponsor youth, Duel and Brooke are saying only $60, since the youth is doing their 50, would sponsor a youth completely. So,
and to do that,
we'll go to the giving page and click under youth. And then just, if you can put a note in it, this is for.
Yeah, there should be an option for
notes. But if you see $60.
Oh, well, no.
$60?
Yeah, it was 60. It was on the announcement video.
60. Okay.
Well,
that doesn't mean it's right.
Well.
Yeah, so... I also didn't plan on, I mean, I don't know, but I was going to, I forgot to ask you about this before we started.
Oh, great.
Sorry. We are getting a divorce.
Oh my gosh.
You said their boat should sink.
That was worse.
Okay, so I was thinking a lot today, and I talked to, as you know, I talked to Mark.
Yes.
I always get Mark and Mike backwards. I was talking to Mark today about making a new team, and I've already talked to the particular people about this team. We really wanted to move into the new year with a lot more small groups, and one of the things that we're trying to do is make a team to reach out to beyond prayer requests. So we really don't want to have this gap of if you're coming to church and you're putting a prayer request on the Connect card and you're dropping it in the box, we have our prayer team, and those always get sent to our prayer team. But then you, I always think about the people on the other side, like, did they get it? Did they, are they praying for me? And yeah. Some of them are very, very sad. And so we wanted to have a team that basically, besides the prayer team, that will reach out to them either email or by phone and just say, hey, we've been praying for you. This is on the prayer request. Also, what else can we do for you? And just continue to touch base with them over the next couple weeks so they're not, what?
No.
So they're not, you know, feeling alone. And also, in that same breath, that team will be, if somebody comes and they give their life to Jesus on a Sunday, they're not just, here's a Bible, read it, and we'll see you next Sunday, hopefully.
Yeah.
So they're going to kind of connect with them after that Sunday, and I think...
Go ahead. Nothing. Comment, you have to think the comments are behind.
So, yeah, so I think that'll be really good. And then you and I have been talking that we've really, and then also with Mark, been talking about having a very special mentor ministry of, I don't want to say this in a bad way, but older Christians.
Mature Christians.
Yeah.
There you go.
I had a joke and I'm not going to say it anyway. So, mature Christians, that would be for a male group and then a female group that would be able to, start mentoring young Christians and going in that direction. And we want to have a really strong men's group and a really strong women's group. And, that'll be something coming up in January.
Okay.
So we've got classes. Mark told me about these classes and everything. So we're going to look into it, and hopefully that rolls out in January and February. Surprise, Philip.
Does. Well, also, and shout out to DS Ellenwood. I believe they came several months, a while back. So that's cool that they're still watching. Tell us what the temperature is up there in Ohio, just because I'm curious. I also, with that, you know, and I'm not going to give too much out because we're not sure exactly how it's all going to work yet, but I did get hold of a new tool today to help make additional content from the sermons and the messages and stuff coming out, and I'd really like to get some small groups going off of that, which if it works out correctly, the small groups, actually, you wouldn't need to really prepare anything or any of that. We can give you the material, and then you just walk through the material, and basically it would just be kind of like what this is, but in a small group setting where you just break through the sermon, break down the sermon, and talk more over it and study within a little group like that. But that's something I need to hash out with you behind the scenes first and get those kind of things going. But there's a lot of stuff that we're working on. You know, we don't just sit in here and do nothing during the day. Kelsey
and I. No,
that's
on Tuesdays.
We keep our foot very much on the gas, trying to do everything we can to further the gospel of Jesus and get things farther out. Was there any more announcements?
No, that's pretty much it. And I mean, I think 2025, I remember if that was the year, we are really trying to be more than just Sundays, and trying to think in the most creative ways possible that it's more not necessarily having to be in the building, but you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Where we don't have to sit here and slot out times where everyone has to meet, even if it's on a Zoom or something.
Yeah,
phone
though, that's
or...
that's my vision and dream goal kind of thing.
Oh, and Amanda's book club starts tomorrow.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
That information, excuse me, is on our Facebook. That was the weirdest cough. Yeah, that's on our Facebook, and the book and everything is on Amazon.
And always, if anybody has any ideas, I'm not saying that immediately we'll jump on them, because I think what we've learned a lesson in the last year is, and we get excited about starting new things, is we'll have people reach out and be like, I want to have this small group, and I told that to Mark today. You know, I want to have this small group. I want to do this. I really have a passion for making bread, and I want to make a... I don't know. That was just random. But, and we get excited and we try to make a small group for them. Oh, no. Trying to make a small group for them, and then they get tired of it in 2 weeks, and now it's our small group, and we don't really have a passion for making
bread. And that's not something I'm going to do. I'm not taking
it. But again, if anyone has any ideas or really are feeling a push for something to do a small group, you can always reach out to us. Email, if you don't know how to reach us directly, it's always info@familychurch.social. Or if you reach us directly, it's just our names, Kelsey Cochran at familychurch.social, you know.
Oh, no, don't say that.
Why?
That's too many people. I've always had a big desire and vision for small groups. And I think, apart from that, one of the things that I would like to see is just the small groups, like what I was saying with like the sermon material, just diving into that, because that'll help. It's kind of like a Bible study type of thing, but you wouldn't have to worry about preparing anything, because we would handle all of that through this tool, which makes it easier on everyone. The other side of it is, like you were just saying, lots of people have great ideas, and they don't know how to execute it, or they don't understand that.
And please know, like
anything, you have to build from the ground up. Yeah, no, we don't jump on in everything, because
it's been too many times this last year.
There's a lot of people that want to jump on what looks successful or what they appear to be successful, and because they want their own type of success. Or they don't want to go through the bare bones process of building things up. And we're doing that with this church. I mean, yes, it is established, but we're kind of reinventing the wheel in a lot of ways, and building it differently and building upon it, but also building in. It's just a lot of behind the scenes things like that. But you have to realize with small groups, what makes them work is small groups. It's a small group. You start small, you build a community with these people, and then it kind of becomes like a family. And
well, you don't run around places with a group of 15 to 20 people.
No.
You run around with a group of five.
The other side is, you know, when you're starting something, there's a tendency to think that it's not successful because one or two people show up. God will put who needs to be there in that moment, and then you build upon that. So take that as you will. But that's just all the stuff that we're working on.
Yeah, take it as you will.
So with that, we're here to discuss CONTEND. What was this? Episode 7, I think it was. Yeah, because I'm already.
I can't stand when you say episode.
Episode. I don't like saying week because it's a series. What do you say when you're watching this? When you're watching a series on Netflix, you don't say, "Oh, this is week 7 of Game of Thrones." You say it's episode 7 of Game of Thrones from season 1 or season 2.
Well, you're the entertainment preacher, so
yes, I'm a terrible person. I will admit it.
Oh, where'd you go?
What, this?
Put that thing back.
What, this?
No.
I'm checking the comments first.
Okay.
What are you looking for?
I'm looking for that.
I switched to this, and then you said go back.
No. That thing.
I know. Okay. I'm getting there. So with that, we're actually going to use some of these discussion points and kind of soft roll some stuff out. So obviously, you know the drill.
Here. What? So the one comment that... Don't even look at me like that, because you're on stage bebopping around to 50 different subjects, so I can be ADHD too,
Jesus
buddy.
Jesus is the subject.
Okie dokie. So, I was thinking about, because I really, it's very intimidating being up here, because you have all the other people that you bring up here. I mean, shoot, even Jason, they're like, la, 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 and they say such educational things. And I'm like, ha, ha, you want to hear a funny story? So, but anyway, I was trying to think of your quotes, and it's really hard when you're working sound.
Well, you're doing like 97 different jobs.
And so I'm trying to listen to you, and then, you know.
Really? Somebody clip that up.
Trying to listen. So anyway, the one thing that really stood out to me was, and I think Tammy even said it in your comments on Facebook, was that if you don't feel convicted or you can sleep with your sin, you should be scared.
Yeah, you should never be able to sleep in your sin, because, I mean, obviously, once you get to that point, what am I doing here?
Oh, my Lord.
Once you get to that point, that's when you're in danger of the unforgivable sin that the Bible mentions, because you are hardening your heart against the Holy Spirit. And then, obviously, the Holy Spirit is what convicts us of our sin. That way we have the That way we know and understand the need for repentance. And when you get to the point that your sin no longer bothers you, you're not being convicted by it anymore. That's when you have hardened your heart, and that's when you get to the point that you can sin and sleep and it doesn't bug you anymore. And that's when it's a dangerous place, because you're at risk of completely hardening your heart against the Holy Spirit, where you don't think you need Jesus anymore, and then you completely turn your back on him, and then you end up on the wrong side of eternity, which...
I remember
we're trying
quote.
To prevent that.
Anyway, you can
so with that, let us know what your favorite quote was. We're obviously, I didn't bring my notes tonight, so this is 100% just off of memory and on the fly. But we were in Jude 20 and 21, talking about building yourself up, praying in the Holy Spirit, keeping yourself in the love of God, and waiting for the return of Jesus Christ. That was the four things. We talked about how to pray, because a lot of people, when they skim the Bible, they just read the Bible at surface level, and if you don't dive in and you just take that surface level skimming, if you will, of the scriptures, and say that five times fast, you'll read, you know, praying in the Holy Spirit, and you'll think, oh, you're supposed to pray in tongues. But praying in tongues is something you can do, obviously, for your own personal benefit, for a lack of a better term, but you do it on your own personal...
Why don't you tell the story of the lady?
The lady? Oh, I did. I talked about it from the pulpit. So if you remember the previous week, at the end of the message, I prayed against witchcraft. We've had it pop up twice now, well, more than that, but one blatant one where either I was in the zone or God blocked me from hearing it, and other people handed it. I know. And so the worst one was, the last one that happened was during communion, and apparently someone was back there screaming in tongues.
Well, not screaming, that's a little
bit. Well, whatever, they were very loud. in a corporate setting, when tongues happens, somebody is supposed to immediately interpret it.
That's in the Bible.
Yeah. And on the other side of that, this was during communion. It was a very holy moment, very somber moment, very reflecting moment. God's not going to hijack something like that with what was going on in the rear of the room
and
someone
pause.
Praying in tongues. But hang on one second. They weren't praying in tongues through the Holy Spirit. They were praying in tongues through the demonic, which was witchcraft. So... that's been handled. They will not be coming in the building anymore. I'm a man of my word.
Because
I do not bluff.
Hit them with his car?
Anyways, what were you saying?
No. Jason, don't drag me into this. I don't know why I give him a southern accent. No, I was just going to say, if anyone's watching, like, you're not trying to say don't be in the moment and don't get emotional and don't, like, cry and don't. It was an obvious...
No, it was
like,
yeah,
you're not saying, like,
that.
Be silent when I speak. Like, it was an obvious...
No, at that moment, that was not
bad.
Anything going on with what communion was. It was somebody actively working in the demonic to try to hinder the moment or stop the moment, pray against the church, pray against me, pray against the members of this congregation. There's no telling what exactly they were doing, but the point is... I mean, we're walking through Jude. We're learning about false prophets and learning about contending for the faith. This is the stuff that happens. Like I've said it numerous times before, when you start kicking back at hell, hell starts kicking back at you. There's more reason to attack you. That's why when you're in the world, it's really not all that bad per se, because you are belonging to the world. You're belonging to Satan. The minute you belong to Jesus and give your life to Jesus and start following him, all of hell starts coming against you because it wants you to fall away again. Mm-hmm. It doesn't want you to go to heaven. They want you to go to hell. So that whole demonic, that's the thing, and I'll speak on it more, not necessarily tonight, but as we walk through this ministry and the life of this ministry, just we need to get back to the spiritual biblical worldview. We don't look at things like that. We look at, and I'll bring it up Sunday in one of the scriptures, where all of the stuff that Jesus healed people from, with like demonic possession and all that, when you read the descriptions of it, it sounds like what we would now call a medical condition, mm-hmm. like a seizure or being mute or something like that. All of that stuff in the Bible times and according to the biblical writers, all of it was supernatural. It was spiritual. That's why Jesus came against. Now, that's obviously not everything is a demon. Like, yes, there are medical conditions
we
and things like that.
We had this talk the other night.
But the reality is, much of it is demonic. And we don't believe that anymore because, you know, we get a headache and we go pop a couple aspirin or Tylenol or ibuprofen instead of, hey, maybe this is something attacking my mind, just strictly trying to get me not to focus. We don't look at addiction and depression and stuff like that. We look at that like it's a medical condition, and oh, you can go take, see, somebody heard it right there. You can go take antidepressants, and we don't look at it as, hey, this is a demonic entity, a demonic spirit that's attacking you and trying to bring you down and make you depressed. We don't have the supernatural worldview anymore because we've just kind of grown out of it as a society, and that's unfortunate, and that's really sad. But we've got to get back to realizing, like, there's a whole supernatural realm, and it's more real than what we're walking in right now. We just don't see it. That's why we don't believe it.
Yeah. So it's okay to and I'm gonna try to speak for the other side of things. It's I myself am still trying to wrap my head around that. Like, we had that talk when, what was it, the night before Thanksgiving?
Yeah.
When Brooke and Rodney and all the kids spent the night, and it was just us four on the couch. And, of course, Brooke and I are very much alike, where we're like, what if we miss the rapture? And we always ask you a million times.
That's why I looked at both of y'all in the sermon and said, you're not going to
miss it. It's okay. And that's the biggest thing, you know, it's okay to have these doubts. It's okay to, because even still, when you talk about that stuff, I've got like 50% of my brain is just kind of looking at you, just blinking, I don't know how to explain it. Just kind of like, And then the other half, because of what I've personally experienced, is like, okay, yeah, no, you're right. But then the other half of my brain cannot wrap my head around it. And then on top of that, with, you know, being a nurse for a while, you know, you are programmed to, so like, again, when it comes to like the anxiety and stuff, you know, 50% of me is kind of like, well, you know, deep breathing exercises could probably help, you know, like I'm trying to,
The thing too,
you know what I'm saying?
And the way that we've grown out of it is we're like that, especially with like being a nurse or something. We're so taught to think rationally. Mm-hmm. There's nothing, when you step back and look at it, and this is a very generalized, broad statement, there's nothing rational, quote, about God. He's supernatural. He's outside of the realm of time. He's omnipotent, omnipresent, all-powerful, all-knowing, always there. I mean, there's nothing rational about that. You can't grasp that with your mind. So, and then being a nurse, you're taught to think rationally. You're taught to think in the natural because you're seeing everything through the natural. We don't have the right connection with the supernatural anymore. Think of it like, so back up all the way to the Garden of Eden. The Garden of Eden was not, and I don't, maybe this is just like baby steps here, but the Garden of Eden was obviously not the entire earth.
Take those with me.
It was not the entire earth. It was just one little plot of land. Mm-hmm. And it was basically like where God would dwell. That's where we were supposed to be fruitful and multiply. We weren't supposed to just stay in Eden. That was where God dwelled. And so he came down. They had they communed with God. They met with God. They talked with God. He would walk in the garden during the cool of the day. And we know that from, that's what it literally says after they sinned.
The cool of the day.
So we as humans used to be able to commune and see and feel God on that same level, but once we sinned, we became disconnected from that, and we don't have that anymore. So obviously, as time went by, we've been separated for so long that, you know, what we once saw, we don't see anymore. And then on the other side of it, since Satan is the God, little g, of this world, and he rules over this world currently, he blinds everybody's minds to it. So that's why we don't really see anything anymore. But once you start digging in and realizing the signs that point to these things, and you study the Bible and you look at the supernatural and the spiritual side of things just through the lens of the Bible, you'll start to see just how real everything is. That's why you see, when you look at the entertainment industry and you see just how blatantly dark and demonic it is now, you can realize, like, this isn't for show. What?
I'm just... Can I say something?
Yeah. Why are you raising your hand?
Because I interrupted you. You're like, hold on 1 second. Hold on, I'm not done. And then you like don't breathe. So I'm just message retracted. How dare you, Amanda? Sorry. No. So we're probably going to get like lose brownie points on this. But the TV show that we were watching.
Whoa. Good.
Is it something mean?
It's right there on the screen. No.
Oh. So the TV show, this was a good example, and it kind of, oh my gosh, this is going to sound so bad. So, you know, you are just talking about the entertainment industry and with demonic and the supernatural, and people are so quick to believe in ghosts. Mm-hmm. But, you know, on the flip side of that, it's, and I was one of them, you know what I mean? Remember how we'd always watch the little... You know, they were dumb. Like, obviously, we knew that they were fake. But I used to just love Halloween, not because I was, you know, wanted to be a witch, but just I loved the season of it. And, you know, I still love that season. But we went to this is not even what I want to talk about, but we went to, like, Halloween Horror Nights this year. And you and I were both really, really bothered. And we left early. Mm-hmm. You know, whereas last year, we were perfectly fine. All the way till the end, I think. I don't even remember.
That so far.
So like this year, you know, it really bothered us to see, because it was just, it was a lot of demonic stuff this year at Universal. And, you know, we left early. But anyway, back to what I was saying was the TV show that we've watched for, you know, Watcher, for what, over a year now? And it's these, it's, I don't know if people know, like, BuzzFeed Unsolved. I'm sure you've heard about it, and I'm sure we'll get someone saying that that's not a Christian show, which it's not. But we've watched them for a while now. It's two guys from this show, and they started their own TV show, and it's kind of, it's, they're making fun of ghost hunting, basically. Mm-hmm. Would that be a good way to describe it?
Yeah.
But I like it because they go to a lot of,
You like the historical setting.
Yeah,
you're just a big history buff.
I love the historical, and then I love Travel Channel stuff. So they go to all these places, and it's basically like a tour of, you know, old buildings in England, and they just do like a ghost hunting, but it's all a joke. Like, they're basically making fun of it the whole time. But what has been interesting lately is that we've both noticed that there's two guys, and then one guy doesn't, would you say he doesn't believe?
One guy, I'm pretty sure, is an atheist. The one guy believes.
He was raised Catholic, and
but,
then he's,
oh, he felt, oh, I don't
he was
that.
Raised Catholic, and he talks about God, but he doesn't believe in ghosts, period, and he's constantly making fun of the other guy, and he just doesn't believe basically in anything. And then the Ryan, the other guy, he completely 100% believes in ghosts. Like, you couldn't convince him otherwise. And what you'd watch is in the beginning of this season when they first started doing this show, remember, he would basically pee his pants if, like, there was a tiny little noise and would like, leave the set. Like, he would leave because he got so scared, remember? Mm-hmm. And then as time passed, you watched him slowly get braver and braver and braver and then start to mock all the sounds they're hearing and stuff like that. And they would say some stuff that would make you and I wince. Like, they would say,
oh, they don't know what they're dealing with. They don't know what
they would just make
about.
A big joke. They'd be like, you know, I don't even want to say, you know, like, come out. Mm-hmm. Demons. And they would just, they wouldn't even be saying ghosts. They would just be, they started just saying, like, demons as a joke. And then we've watched, I would say, what, the last three or four episodes, you think? It's been progressively the stuff that they've been getting back feedback-wise. Like, before, they would hear nothing, and it would just all be, like, silly stuff. But now, it's the machines that they're using. It's,
yeah, the responses are getting
more. And they're still making a joke about it, but the responses are getting more and more pointed to the fact of you can't ignore.
Well, yeah, that's the thing. Is it's almost like it's like an open case study of how you devolve when you quit thinking about things correctly and you quit having the right view, which, not that they had really the right view to begin with. Mm-mm. But they've opened themselves up to it so much, even just by saying jokes, that now you're starting to see they're getting responses. And you can write it off if you're not a believer, but being a believer and knowing that this realm is true, you start to realize the stuff that they're getting is very much probably a demon speaking to them. Now, obviously, there is no such thing as ghosts. When you die, you either go to heaven or you go to hell. You're not waiting around. You're not waiting around in purgatory. There's nobody that has died and stayed on the earth.
I mean, I will if I die first and you get remarried, but...
Or any of that kind of thing.
Just joking, guys.
So all of the ghosts that these people try to hunt, it's just demonic spirits. It's demonic spirits floating around. And it's a really bad thing here in St. Augustine because we're, you know, I don't know if it's the most haunted city. I know it's the oldest city in the nation, but I don't know if they also say it's the most haunted. But I do know, you know, there's so many haunted places downtown.
I can't remember who told me.
And everybody just buys into it.
The Indeed listing for the paid ghost. They, like, pay people to be the ghost.
I've never heard of that.
Yeah, it was on an Indeed, and I guess it was not supposed to be public, and somebody saw it be public.
Oh.
Somebody told me that. I can't remember who that was.
I don't know. I've never heard of that.
Somebody told me that.
But, yeah, it's just, I mean, that's the sad thing. But, I mean, you see that, and like Jude says that, and the Bible says, you know, in the last days there's going to be scoffers, and it's just, it's unfortunate to watch. But, you know, that's just the reality of the situation. It's the sad truth is just that as much as we want to save everyone we can, not everybody's going to accept it. And it's sad to also watch something that I'll be speaking on this coming Sunday, too, is the people that get corrupted just by being in the company of someone that doesn't believe, someone that is an atheist or anything like that. You don't realize... You start to fall away by being in bad company. Mm-hmm. You know, that's why they always say, you know, show me your friends, I'll show you your future kind of thing. And just not enough people realize that. And they don't realize, you know, when you're not, man, I gotta be careful not to preach my Sunday sermon, but when you're not in the right mindset and you're not mature enough as a Christian, you can't, it's not a good idea to go into these kinds of places. It's basically like if you were an addict and you just got clean, that's the equivalent of you going and hanging back out with all the people that are still doing the things, thinking that you can help them get clean. But you're not, I mean, you can have all of the confidence in the world, but the truth is you're probably just not ready yet and been out of it enough to where you won't fall back into temptation. Mm-hmm. It's that same kind of thing with Christians. Like, if you're not built up in your faith enough, you can be corrupted simply by being in bad company.
Interesting.
Yeah. So, you want to...
Sorry. You're never going to let me come back on here ever again.
I'm ready for my throat to quit messing up. So let's hit some of the questions.
Well, quit yelling.
I'll read some off. I know that we've got a delay between those. That's a good one. What ways... Well, that's pretty much what we just... okay, so in what ways would you say that people are spiritually asleep in their lives, and how can we wake up to God's calling?
Good question. Jared?
I mean, that's essentially what we were just talking about.
Yeah.
Not having that deep well of Christianity, you know, not having that biblical knowledge, like I say all the time, where, you know, America and plenty of people are just biblically illiterate that you don't know. And then the same thing where you compromise your faith and beliefs and you're just asleep. What?
Nothing.
You breathed out like
thinking.
You were needing to say something.
No.
What? You want to read one?
No. I was just thinking. Go ahead. I was just thinking.
Okay. Sheesh.
No. Spiritually asleep in our lives. You know. I mean, if you think about it, spiritually asleep. Okay, maybe I'm not thinking about this the right way because I don't know. But, you know, you get up every single morning and you do a Bible study, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it becomes like clockwork. You get up, you do a Bible study, you almost make it a task. You know what I mean? Because you've been doing it for 15 years. You've been doing it the same way. And that maybe was a way you were getting fed 15 years ago. But now it's just become like this. And it's a great habit. But you know what I'm trying to get at? You know,
yeah, it's
you get up in the morning, you do the same thing, and then you move on, and you're not really changing because of it. You could almost say that'd be spiritually asleep, you know? And then how can we wake up to God's calling? I guess if you're hopefully come to the realization, you're sitting there and you're going, I'm not really feeling very passionate about this anymore. Hopefully you come to that realization. If you do, I guess the first thing to do would be look at your day to day. And like you just said, who are we hanging out with? You know, who are you hanging out with? Who, what are you saying? What are you doing? That type of thing. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. I look at it like what you were saying. It's essentially what you just said is what I was saying on Sunday about routine. So obviously it's good to have a routine.
Mm-hmm.
But the routine is not what makes you righteous. And so you can be spiritually asleep to where like that, you're waking up, and it's not that it's wrong to be waking up and having that routine and doing the devotional, but like that, I mean, you hit the nail on the head when you're not passionate about it anymore and you're doing it to just be doing it.
You become a Pharisee
because it's routine. It's what you've always done. You feel like it's, you need to do it. Mm-hmm. And it's not because you want to do it. The whole thing of a relationship is because you want to do it. That's how you truly seek after, you know, that's how you seek after your spouse. That's how you seek after God. That's how you work in a relationship, is truly wanting to grow in that relationship. So there's many people that are just spiritually asleep because they think salvation is just accepting Jesus and then, you know, sitting in a church pew for a Sunday and then doing nothing else. So you have nobody, you have a bunch of people not growing in their walk, not growing in their faith because they're just going through the motions and, you know, oh, well, I come to church on Sundays, you know, all the time, or, you know, whatever, once in a blue moon, or, you know, I do this and I do that. And it's like, no, it's not about that. Like, you need to be genuinely having a heart and a passion for Jesus.
Okay. So that's really easy to say. What would you say to someone that came to you and they said, I think I'm spiritually asleep. I have absolutely I don't know what to do. I don't know why that was really hard to say. I've read the Bible 4 times. I have a master's degree in theology. I've been a youth pastor for 15 years. I'm not a youth pastor anymore, but I'm spiritually asleep. I literally don't know what else to do. What would you say?
Pray.
No. Okay,
that's all it boils down to. I mean, that's how you should be approaching. That's how you should be approaching Bible study. That's how you should be approaching really anything with God is obviously talking to God. The Bible, like I said Sunday, Ephesians, pray without ceasing. You should be praying all the time. And then when you come to the Bible, don't just open up the Bible. I try to always, before I sit down, you know, God, send your Holy Spirit, help me, you know, speak to me through your word. Show me what you want to show me. Don't just let me be reading words. Like, open your scriptures to me. God, you know, like it says in, I think, Proverbs, it's the glory of God to conceal a thing, but it's the glory of kings to search it out. So when you're genuinely searching it, and you're not just doing it for, you know, routine, or, yeah, you've got all that head knowledge, you know, I've got a master's degree, and I've got this, and I've got that.
Well, like, some of us are...
But is your heart actually in it?
Some of us are, like me, I'm going through and trying to read the Bible front to cover, one page, you know, so, you know, we kind of do have to just go through it, but... Okay, you know, let's say, I'm not trying to be a jerk here. I'm literally not trying to pick on you. But let's say he says, I have been praying and I haven't heard anything. Because that's a possibility, you know. What would you recommend?
It's cliche. It's the same answer. You keep going after God. You think of the intertestamental period.
I know, but that's what you would say. You'd just be like, okay, we'll keep praying.
What else are you going to do?
No, I'm just saying, would you say, what else? Like, say there's somebody watching right now, and they're like, oh my goodness gracious, she's talking about me. Like, what would you say to them? You would say pray, obviously, but they would be like, well, I'm not hearing anything at all.
What are you praying? Look at your prayer life. What are you actually praying? Like, how do you approach? That's why I broke down praying in the message. How do you genuinely pray? like I think Mitch has said it before, it's a great exercise to, when you pray, record yourself and then play it back and see what it sounds like.
Oh, that's horrific.
If you start your prayer and you're like, give me, give me, give, like that kind of thing, that's not praying.
That's for the people that like to hear their voice, honey. That's
no, it's not. It's so you can see how you're praying. Then don't record yourself, but step back next time you pray and think about your words. You know, Matthew 6:9, the Lord's Prayer. Go through that and realize that it's not a script. It's a blueprint to show you how to pray. That's why he says pray like this. You start with that reverence. You start with showing God his honor because that's what he deserves. You start with like acts, A-C-T-S, adoration, Jesus. Confession, thanksgiving, and supplication. Like supplication is you asking for stuff for yourself or for others. That's all the way at the end of the list. You start with worshiping God. You start with adoration. You start with just praise and worship. Worship God for who he is.
Yeah.
Confess your sins before him. Thank him for what you have. And then you start asking him stuff. But generally, what a lot of people do is we jump into prayer because we're too busy and we feel like we don't have a bunch of time. So it's you know, God, I don't have enough gas to get me to work. Help me to get to work. God, help me with this court case. God, help me with this. Help this go in my face. And it's just, God, do this. And it's like, but what are you doing for God? So, I mean, that's literally my answer. If you're reading the Bible, consider how you're reading it. Consider how you're praying. Think of, like, truly have a heart search. Mm-hmm. Because you can have all of the head nod to everything. You got to get real. You got to get raw. It's got to be that heart check. You have to step back and realize, like, how am I actually approaching God? How am I actually doing this? Because you know, yeah, I'm reading the Bible cover to cover, and I'm trying to find stuff. Okay, ask God to reveal things for you. That doesn't mean he's going to throw everything up in your face right off the bat. It doesn't mean you're going to hear him, you know, all this super loud noise and this and that. He can be a still small voice. He can speak, to you in one way, but he can speak to you in a different way. And so you can't put God in that box. You gotta step back and think, like, okay, why isn't God answering me? Am I praying the wrong things? Am I asking for the wrong things? Am I seeking God's will? That's why the Bible, you know, seek first the kingdom of God. Am I seeking God first? Am I actually seeking God, or am I doing this for the wrong reasons?
Yeah.
So, you know, that's how I approach the Bible. Just jumping in, the same thing with study. God, there's not a day that goes by that I'm not praying for Sunday's message, like, God, show me what you want me to say. I don't ever jump into the word like, all right, what's this going to be like? No, I'm like, God, you lead me this week, every week, right at the beginning of the week. As soon as the one sermon ends, I'm already on the next one. Like, God, show me what you want me to say. Lead me through this word. And like, for instance, this morning, when I got up at 5 and started, I didn't start reading the Bible for my sermon. I actually opened up. I went through the one devotional that we're doing together, and then I have a Christmas one
that I'm 4 days behind.
And then that's fine. Don't beat yourself up.
Okay.
And then I went through. I went through just my daily year through the Bible plan. And as I read that, it literally, two brackets of scripture in just that, from just what would be my normal daily reading plan, two brackets of that made its way into Sunday's sermon because it directly spoke to what Jude goes. And that's just how it works. Like, you just start seeking in God. I mean, when you genuinely seek God and ask him to reveal things to you, he will. And that doesn't mean he'll do it right away, but that doesn't mean you give up. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
You have anything to say?
No.
No, just get to sit there and look pretty.
Well, you're not breathing, so.
I breathed. So what do you think?
No, you said it all. It was good. These are very long sentences. I can't read that fast.
Okay. What? So one of the good questions, since we're in contend, one of the questions is, what does it mean to truly contend for the faith in today's world? And how can we do so effectively? So
arguing with everybody on St. Augustine News.
Huh?
Nothing. I said arguing with everybody on St. Augustine News.
That's, I'm ready to leave that page because it's such a terrible thing. I love that though. That lady said, Tracy said, worship is not just for Sunday church time. I think that's what a lot of people fail at is they think this is the only time to worship. Like this is the time to gather and do it corporately. Like mm-hmm. we're supposed to gather. Hebrews says we're supposed to gather, but that's why you see a lot of dumpster fire TikTok theology talking about you don't need to come to church and all that. No, we're supposed to gather together as the body.
Well, that's isolation.
Exactly. That's another form of the false prophet trying to... we'll get different ones. Trying to isolate you to lead you astray. And a lot of people will unfortunately fall for it. They think, you know, and it could boil down to something as simple as... You haven't found a good, maybe there's not really a good church in your immediate area. Maybe you disagree with a lot of the stuff the churches do in your area. And so you're having a hard time finding a place to connect. I mean, I think that's the beauty of being able to live stream and have the online body. But I do think it is still good to find a place to gather with mm-hmm. the saints. But it, that, you know, that false prophet, that false Christian thing, it's all about, I mean, you see it. Not just for trying to get you out of the church, but also the proselytizing, where they're trying to literally pull you away from the church that you're already plugged in to whatever they're leaving to go do. And, you know, that's never a good thing. I already forgot the question. Oh, contending for the faith. And I had asked this, I think, in the music chat. And, you know, that's the whole point of contending for the faith. And the thing with Sunday is like that need to build yourself up and to be biblically rooted, and then reading the Bible for obviously your relationship, but also so that you know it, to keep the book on your lips. That way when, you know, you think of how Jesus was tempted by the enemy, by Satan in the wilderness, where he always responded with, "It is written," because he knew what was written. He knew the word. I mean, he is the word, but he knew the word. So he didn't try to engage in a conversation with the devil and be like, "Oh no, you're just dumb, you're stupid," and blah blah blah. No, he like literally fought back with God's word, because that's why God's word is the sword. That's why you need to understand it. You need to realize it is a weapon. Your prayer is a weapon. Your praise is a weapon. Your worship towards God is a weapon. You have literally the sword of truth. The only thing holding you back from fighting and contending for the faith is yourself.
Yeah. So when you say contend up on the stage, I think a lot of times, and this may just be me, a lot of times people think that it means big action. So when you're like, you know, you need to contend for the faith, and it's all get out there, big action stuff, everything like that, it doesn't have to always be big action. You know, it can be something as simple as your interaction with somebody at the cash register. You know, it can just be, it can be something very, very, very small that you don't think would be a very big deal. But in that moment, you are contending for the faith. When someone says something and you are standing up by saying, "Hey, you know, that's maybe, please don't say that," or even something as small as that. That's a big deal. It means just as much as a big, elaborate, daily, massive Facebook post mm-hmm. to 950 people. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, and I think that's something a lot more people need to understand is contending for the faith is not getting on a stage. It's not having a we all have a platform on social media. So obviously, like, you can contend for the faith by living out the Christian lifestyle on social media. You know, if you're posting Bible verses one day, and then every Friday, Saturday night, everybody's seeing on your story that you're down at the club and yeah. living the same way that they are, they're not going to take you seriously. And that's not contending for the faith. 1 Peter 3 says to First Peter 3:15 says, "But in your hearts honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you, yet do it with gentleness and respect. So we're not called to be, obviously, jerks when we contend for the faith. Now, that brings up other issues where you see Elijah, where he was mocking the false prophets of Baal and Asherah, where you see, I mean, Jesus even mocked them as well. But to be gentle and be respectful, and I'll speak more on this kind of thing on Sunday with having mercy. If you look ahead in Jude 22 and 23, with having mercy towards people. But like that, like you said, like being in the grocery store, and there's so many different ways. You don't have to be a pastor. You don't have to have this big platform. You don't have to be famous. You don't have to have all of this stuff. You know, for some people, contending for the faith is getting in your prayer closet, in your secret place, and praying to God, getting on your knees, getting on your face, and just praying to God to help save the lost, to help grow the church, to help do this, to help God's will further, to help his kingdom further on the earth, contending for the faith like that. In the grocery store, looking at, you know, if somebody says something and you just not standing there silently. When one of your coworkers or your family members at Thanksgiving or the Christmas table now, because that's the next one coming up, when they start knocking you for, and I don't know if Jason minds if I use this, but he was talking about, I think he put it in the music chat, so I'm assuming it'll be fine to use, but he said something about this guy that he used to hang out with that came to work, and he asked him what he was up to, and he said, you know, just going to church and stuff, and the guy said, oh, so you're not having fun anymore. Contending for the faith in that situation is standing up for not just yourself, but standing up for God. And, you know, being a Christian doesn't mean not having fun. But that's the thing, is a lot of people, they don't want to contend because they want to avoid conflict. Yes. And avoiding conflict is not how you contend for the faith. You have to be able to be confrontational. That doesn't mean punching people in the face.
It's confrontational.
Yeah. But
fine.
There's that side, you know, contending for the faith. When you drive up to drop your kid off at school and you see a bunch of rainbow stuff in the windows with, you know, pride, and you look at the books and stuff that they're putting in schools, and contending for the faith in that situation would be, I don't know about just going straight into the office. Or
when you're driving to the parking garage to see your friend who just went in the hospital and a lady almost hits you, you don't flick them off.
Yeah.
I didn't.
That's good.
I said,
I don't know if that's contending for the faith as much as just having self-control, which is good.
I was loud, but I mean, I don't think she could hear me.
Oh, that's good. I thought you were just praying for. But it's those, it can be simple things. I think a lot of people think that it's like just the pastor's job to do stuff, and they put so much reliance on the pastor, and it's like, man, you've got the Holy Spirit in you as much as I have the Holy Spirit in me. And the same thing for those, if you're a Christian, you have the Holy Spirit in you just as much as we do, as I do. It's not like he's in me more than he's in you. He's in me the same. He just uses me in a different way. He uses you in a different way. We all have different, that's why it's many parts to the body. Not everybody is just, there you go.
That was a big word.
It's not just a bunch of, you know, think if everybody was a left hand, how are we supposed to walk? Kind of thing.
You don't walk on your hands.
Like, well, exactly. You need all different parts of the body enabled.
Left hand. I was trying to be funny because you're all uptight.
I'm not uptight. Ugh. But no, that's the thing. There's so many different ways. It doesn't have to be this big loud thing. It can be praying in secret. It can be going and having a parent teacher conference and saying to the office or whatever for the teacher board, you know, hey, this is wrong. You need to get this stuff out of schools, and standing up, because a lot of people now that they just want to avoid confrontation. So they remain silent, thinking that, you know, oh, it'll just work itself out. No, it won't work itself out. It will get worse. Yeah. Because when they put something in front of you, or they get away with something and they test you on it, and you say nothing and you do nothing, then it turns into, oh, well, we got away with this, so now we're going to push a little further. Mm-hmm. I mean, you think of it like a military tactic. If we're fighting here and you start taking ground and they do nothing and then you just keep taking ground and they don't ever push back, eventually you get up to them and you completely take them over.
Unless you didn't know about the covered ditch and the tripwire, then that ends up being bad for you.
What in the world was that?
Next question. Tanya said she's having a lot of fun as well.
She's having a blast.
I agree, Tanya. This has been a really fun year. I've really been enjoying it. I really, really don't regret it.
Did we already do this one? The surface level? How can we develop a prayer life that goes beyond... I think we just did that one.
Jeez.
That goes beyond surface level and truly aligns with God's will. I mean,
I don't even know what the next one
Matthew
even means, 6. So let's not do that one.
This?
Yes.
In what ways... might we inadvertently
twisting
grace into a license for licentiousness in our own lives or our communities?
I'm reading deliciousness when I question.
No, so. These are the people that abuse grace. That's that's the simplest way to put it. So it's you've already been forgiven, but you keep going back and doing the same thing, essentially just living in sin. So we'll just go hot and heavy. You're living together as boyfriend and girlfriend, doing all the stuff that comes with that.
Making cakes, going grocery shopping, vacuuming.
Yeah, all that kind of stuff. Already being in the same household and not being married, you're opening up that door to temptation. That's just the reality of the situation. You can say whatever you want to say. Stuff's going to happen. So twisting it is... you know, oh, well, God knows we're in love. God knows we're going to get married. We've already got the wedding date set, so, you know, he doesn't mind. He doesn't mind that we're having sex while we're not married. He doesn't mind that we're doing this. Or, you know, you go and you do something like that, or you look up porn. I don't know if that's going to kick off on the internet.
Shmorn.
And then, you know, you... whatever with that, and then at the end of it, you're like, oh, God, forgive me. I don't want to do this again. And there's one thing with struggling with something that you're dealing with. The other side of it is like you do something, and then you're like, oh, God, forgive me, and then you go back and do it again. Oh, God, forgive me, and then you go back and do it again. And then eventually you're just not asking for forgiveness because you think, oh, well, God loves me. He knows my heart. He's going to forgive me anyways. That's twisting grace into that license for licentiousness. The other way to put it is basically like a license to sin. That's jumping back way into the beginning of the series of Jude on Jude with just twisting grace and doing everything like they thought. The false prophets of that time, they thought that they were so spiritual that it didn't matter what they did with their bodies. So they thought that they had complete freedom, which we do have freedom as Christians, but they thought that they could go have a homosexual relationship and do all of this, or, you know, nowadays it'd be, you know, that kind of thing, or going and having a bunch of drugs or a big orgy party and all this stuff. I mean, that's what they were doing. But they figured that they were forgiven. That's like the once saved, always thing, always saved thing. And then you just keep, you think that you can do whatever you want under the sun, but and God will always forgive you. Mm-hmm. Which, yes, he does forgive you, but that doesn't give you the reason or the ability to abuse grace and expect him to forgive you. Because obviously we know that he didn't have to do any of it. He didn't have to forgive us. He didn't have to die on the cross for our sins. And when we live that way, and we, like Dad just said, the cheap grace thing, when we live that way and it means nothing to us, that's just like making a mockery of the cross.
Yeah. Next question.
Next question.
I said I didn't understand that question. You said it anyway. I don't know what you want from me, okay? I'm just here because all the smart people aren't in town.
Oh, my gosh.
Oh, my gosh. Ooh.
Which one?
I don't know.
How can you cultivate... I'm still waiting for y'all to answer these things in the chat. I guess they are on YouTube.
Facebook.
How can we cultivate a deeper sense of urgency? I love this one. In our faith without succumbing to fear or anxiety.
Can you go back to the question? Because you read it so fast. Thank you.
Because we have comments that I'm trying to engage with.
Well, you have a mentally handicapped wife up here that's trying to read. Just joking.
How can we cultivate a deeper sense of urgency?
Tough crowd.
A deeper sense of urgency in our faith without succumbing to fear or anxiety.
Because that's not the question for me. I had this morning laying in bed. This probably has nothing to do with this. So this morning I tried really hard because some mornings I really just don't want to read anything because I'm not a reader. I'm really not. I get three sentences in and I'm like just thinking about something else and then reading's tough for me. You like to sit and read for hours on end. That would be destructive. Why'd you make that face? That would be destructive for me because it would just be so frustrating because I read a sentence and then I just go back and it's tough.
Listen to it.
So this morning I'm trying to wake up and I really just wanted to continue to sleep, but I was a big girl and I decided to do my Bible study. So I put it on and I can't remember which one I did because I have like seven unfinished studies in YouVersion because I decided to start a new one and then I get distracted and then I go back. So I was on one of them and it was talking about, I don't know, I was literally half asleep. So I put it on listen and I truly was listening. This sounds really bad, but then I went to the Bible verse and it was describing heaven. And this is how my brain worked. And this is going to sound really bad. And so it's just...
Why do you down yourself so much? You should really stop doing that.
Okay. Now I want to go home because I'm going to cry because you're making fun of me.
No.
So I'm listening to it and it's describing heaven. And it's talking about it and I'm listening to it. And I'm starting to get anxiety listening to it because I'm thinking, well, ever since the one time you told me that people aren't going to know they're married in heaven, now I can't stop thinking about that. Now I'm upset. Then I'm like, well, you're not going to know me in heaven?
And they're
like,
no,
I'm going to know you.
There's no marriage.
But not you as my wife. And then it made me really, really sad. And I'm still thinking about that.
So
and I think you
now.
Said that like 2 months ago. So I got anxiety thinking about heaven. Because the way they're describing, I'm like, oh gosh, what if I don't like, what if I do
There's
the
no
same
way to
thing
not
every
like it.
I know. And reality set in, because again, this was at 6 o'clock in the morning and I was kind of half asleep and I'm listening to it. But to go back to that question,
how do you create a deeper sense of urgency?
Urgency in the faith, as you emphasized, without succumbing to fear or anxiety. I'm asking you.
You read like you were about to continue.
No, I wasn't. Because that's something that I struggle with too, a lot, is actually I struggle with a lot of the Bible, reading it and not getting some type of my own mind taking over and getting anxious about, I don't know, that sounds terrifying, or oh my gosh, what if I don't like that? So it's, that's not the question for me. I cannot help anybody with that question.
For some people, yeah, they're not readers. So in that case, it's good to listen to it.
Yeah.
The other side of that is like, well, for one, it shouldn't be.
Well, the question is about urgency, though.
Anxiety. Well, yeah, because we need a sense of urgency.
Yeah.
Urgency.
We're
running out. Yes, we do. The time is running out. And so we need to be trying to reach as many people as possible instead of, that's why I get up here and scream at everybody about it. To go out and do something, go out and make disciples. I mean, that's literally Jesus's great commission to all of us, to go and make disciples. And I feel like for the most part in this country, a lot of people just want to have the pastor do that. They want to just show up at church, check it off the box, and be done with it. And so we've got to get that sense of urgency back, like the early disciples, the apostles had, where it's like, no, we've got the truth within us and we need to go share it because these people out there that don't know Jesus, they're at risk of spending eternity in hell, eternity separated from God in an eternal lake of fire, eternal death where they just don't die, but it's the most terrible thing forever and ever and ever. That should create so much urgency within each and every person to want to go talk to everybody, you know somebody in your life whether a family member or a friend, that doesn't know Jesus or is rejecting Jesus.
A lot.
And we are called to try and reach those people by any means possible and necessary, trying to, that's cool, trying to reach them and get them to realize the need to wake up.
Well, I guess a good way you could do it without getting very, you know, anxious about it would be make little mini goals, you know? You could, like Jason had told us about the people at his work, make little miniature goals to, let's say Fred at work is really resisting everything. Make a little mini goal, like, hey, this week I'm really going to focus on Fred, you know, and you could make, so you're not super overwhelmed with, you know, well, everybody at my work, you know, hates God. That would be overwhelming and you'd immediately get a little bit stressed out. Well, you know, Pastor said that I need to have urgency with this, and I've got 15 people I work with that don't know anything about Jesus. Yeah, you could try to tackle them all at once, or you could just make little miniature goals, like really just try to hone in on a couple. I don't know if that's a horrible way to do it, but I'm just saying that would maybe avoid being really anxious about it. And I think that the more it's like muscle memory, the more you do something. Like with you getting on stage, the more you got on stage and the more it became muscle memory, the less fearful, the less anxious you got about it. So the more you actually are doing it, I think would be the exact solution. The more you're actually sharing or the more you're doing these particular things, the less anxious you get about it. So you could start, if it's really intimidating, start really just trying to talk to one person at your work. You know, once that becomes not intimidating, then, you know, add a couple more people. And then it becomes, you can start talking to strangers about it. You know, like,
I think for, there's a couple of things I want to dig in on that. So, yeah, honing in on one person. The other,
everything
the other,
you just said is wrong.
No, the other side is there's like, there's the, what's known as the ministry of presence, just being there for somebody. That doesn't mean you always have all the answers for them. Like when somebody's going through.
I think you know
through,
which friend I'm talking about, but there's one friend that I have that's what I'm doing.
But, and that's something, you know, sometimes that's all it takes is you just living holy and living righteous and loving them like Jesus would while not being afraid of hurting their feelings by telling them the truth. Now, that doesn't mean like if you had a gay friend and you're like, hey, you're gay, you're going to hell. That's not going to win anybody to Jesus. It's never won anybody to Jesus. But you loving them and being like, hey, you know, I don't agree with your lifestyle, but I don't view you any less as a person. You know, like, you know, this is what the Bible says, and I believe that, but that doesn't mean I hate you. I still love you.
Julie, so, I'm just like your daughter.
Yeah. So there's
Julie, talk to me with love and explanation.
There's the ministry of presence, but, and then the other side of it is, like, with creating the sense of urgency, and what you were saying, like, about me with preaching. So how I look at it is, and the advice that I've given a couple people, because a lot of people, they won't go talk to someone because they think, oh, well, I'm not going to know what to say, or I don't know enough about the Bible to try to talk about it. So all of that is based,
which is intimidating,
of course, because the enemy's telling you, hey, you don't know enough. You're stupid. You're dumb. You don't have enough stuff. How are you going to win anybody because you don't know the Bible enough? Well, what do you know? You already know some, and you also need to have the courage to, if you go and talk to someone and they ask you a tough question, it's okay to be like, hey, I don't know the answer to that. Let me get back to you. Or I don't know the answer to that. Let's go figure it out together. Mm-hmm. Let's go search it.
In nursing school, that's what they tell you to do when you're going, when they have state come in.
Yeah. So why do we avoid it when it comes to the Bible?
I will go ask somebody that does.
But we avoid that when it comes to the Bible because we think if we don't have, it's like we approach life that way.
Well, can I say something in that? A lot of that is because, like you've made it a point before, that people don't attack Buddhists, people don't attack or Buddhism, people don't attack all those other religions you listed because they really do truly attack Christianity. Yeah. So the biggest thing is it's intimidating because you can have somebody, people are going to be the meanest when it comes to that. So they're going to get the nastiest. Oh, you don't know. Mm-hmm. They're going to get the nastiest. Like you said, they're the ones that attack the hardest and the most. So not only are you going to have someone that's coming against you and saying, oh, you don't know, they're going to come against super nasty because that's just the nature of the topic. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So that's also super, super intimidating in that fact of that.
So Jason's comment directly goes into this conversation. Jason on YouTube for the Facebook people said, sometimes I struggle thinking I have to be the one to save them. Jesus saves them. Jesus saves them. The conviction saves them. The Holy Spirit saves them. That, yeah, Jesus is the one. So we have to quit.
Take the pressure off.
Well, that's the thing. You have to get the pressure off of your shoulders. The only thing on you is to plant the seed. That's it. That's why when I'm like, hey, your blood's not going to be on my hand, I just tell you what needs to be said.
Yep.
You respond however you're going to respond. Mm-hmm. Now, for reaching someone, that's how we look at it as, you know, we approach our job with, oh, I'll ask questions, but I don't know it. But then when it comes to the Bible, we think, I need to study the Bible for 10 years. I was the same way with preaching. I'm not going to step on the stage until I'm ready. And then eventually I was like, no, I just have to do it or I'm never going to be ready, because you're never going to know enough. Mm-hmm. You just have to bring what you have. The same thing when you go and talk to someone. So bring what you have, pray to God, pray to the Holy Spirit, you know, show me, give me the words, because he will. And there's so much that spews out of me on this stage that's just straight from the Holy Spirit, because when I step up here, I mean, it's not just a cliche thing in my prayer, like, God, I'm your vessel, use me. No, that's like literally my whole reliance when I come to preaching is, every week I get to Friday or Saturday and it's, you don't have enough, you didn't bring enough.
Yeah.
You see it all the time at home. I don't know. And then it's just, I approach it, and that's just the attack from the enemy, because it only comes close to Sunday. But every Sunday, every day of the week, it's I know you're going to meet me. That's my full confidence in God, that I know he's going to meet me here and tell me what to say. And he'll give you the words. But like with that, with trying to reach people, it doesn't have to be just you. So you can plant the seed and you can pray for someone, but maybe someone else is supposed to be the one that actually finally reaches that person, but the seed was planted from you,
well,
if that makes sense.
Speaking on that too, like two parts to that is you say like, well, I don't know all the Bible. What you do know is, if you are a Christian, like how you became a Christian, you do know your testimony. So that you do know, you're not going to mess that up. I mean, you might. But on the other hand of that too is, don't always prepare. This is going to sound super backwards, but like, don't always prepare when you're talking to people that you're going to share Christ. Just be like yourself.
Be you.
It's like the story we talked about at Universal.
Yeah.
You know, that I talked to you about the other night. Like at Universal, there was a, it was at Halloween Horror Nights this year.
Was this year or last year?
This year.
It was last year. Oh.
And we were just sitting in the, I say it wrong. Diagon Alley.
Diagon Alley, yeah.
Yeah, diagonally. And we were sitting there just hanging out, because we were just tired of walking around, and honestly, like, we like Harry Potter, and everywhere else was just really scary. And we were sitting there, and it was me at the end of the bench, and I think you were sitting next to me, and then there was a girl, what?
I'm listening. I'm just reading comments.
Not paying attention to me as usual.
You gotta finish?
We were just sitting there, and you and I like to people watch, and there was this girl about our age that was walking. She walked past us, and she was dressed very with the season. Let's just say that. Fair with, you know.
I don't remember, so you just...
We were there.
I don't remember what she was wearing.
Very, like, witchcrafty type of just, you know. And she walked by, kind of glanced at the open seat next to you. You could tell she wanted to sit down, but she wasn't quite sure. And then she kind of walked by and just sat back down and was just, you know, minding her business. And then you had to go to the bathroom. So you got up, and I don't know why, because I think people that know me, like, I'm not going to talk to you. Like, I'm not talking to a stranger.
You barely talk to me.
That's right. And this is the most we talk all week right now. And I'm kidding. And okay. And I looked at her, and I don't know why, but I looked at her, and I said, help me save a seat, just kind of joking around. I don't know why I said that to her, and she just kind of laughed, and then I don't remember. She said something else. She looked kind of scared, and she said something else, and then we just started talking. And she ended up telling me that she had separated from her friends. She was there with her friends on a trip. She was from Louisiana. And she works at a mask shop in Louisiana, one of the big ones. I actually ended up looking it up, but I can't remember the name of it now. And she just started telling me things, and she just started telling me why she was there in Orlando. And she just started dumping, just... They came to her, her friends took her to Orlando because she just survived a sexual assault on her with a deadly weapon at her work. And they were trying to cheer her up by taking her to Halloween Horror Nights. I don't really know why that would be my first thought, but that's what they did. And she had just, they all got completely drunk on her. She was hadn't been drinking because she was just not having a great time because she just survived a traumatic accident and now is at a place where people jump out at you. And they had all gotten drunk earlier in the day and were all in the medic tent getting IVs. And so she was just wandering around by herself in a completely different state. By herself, so she just continued to tell me all this, and she went into detail about her event, and it was definitely traumatic. And I don't know why it's gonna make me cry, but I just was like, "Oh, well, are you Christian?" And she's like, "No, not really." And then it just went from there. And then you came back from the bathroom and came up on us, and I was like, "We're gonna pray." And you just came back from the bathroom, and you're like, "What is going on?" And then we ended up praying for her, and I think she started crying. And then I only got her first name, and I should have gotten her last name, but she just, it's just instances like that where, I mean, I was just making a joke about saving your seat, and it just took off from there. And as those are just an example of just, you know, be ready without really just sitting there constantly, like, "Oh my gosh, I got to be ready today. You know, I got to be ready today." Having
that's
that anxiety,
you always on assignment.
So it's just being ready for moments like that. And that would be a seed. Like, I have no idea what she's doing right now. I haven't stayed in contact with her. I should have, you know, I should have gotten her number, but who knows what she's doing, how she's surviving. You know, it was a very recent thing that she went through, but
well, knowing how you can look people up on the internet, I'm sure you could find her within about 15 seconds.
I tried, but with her being with the extent of what she went through, I think maybe she was in type of a protection program to where she wouldn't be on social media. She wouldn't have a Facebook at this time, just because of how insane the ordeal she just had to go through. So I think you have to be off of public access.
Oh, I have no idea.
Due to all that, I don't want to say anymore.
Well, I was super proud of you for praying publicly for someone like that, because that's contending for the faith, and not a lot of people would do that. But it was a really important moment, and that's just, I mean, that's a testimony to realizing that you're on assignment all the time. What you think are random encounters is God putting you.
But my point was, like, that was not my intention.
Oh, exactly.
Like, I have no idea why I said that. And when I said it, I immediately was like, "Oh, you look like a nerd." as I said that. But then she responded, thankfully, like, pretty well about it, and not, you know, threw her drink in my face. But it was definitely not anywhere close to what I thought the conversation was going to go, you know. And it kind of made me sad because I, like, looking back now after we had gone home, and I don't think I've told you this, but it made me kind of sad because I've had so many opportunities where, like we make a running joke that strangers just tell me things, like, really personal things. Like, any trip we go on, you know, like, they
everywhere
just...
Everywhere we go.
Yeah, they just tell, you know, come up to me and they're like, "Oh, you know, my... husband just murdered, like just the crazy stuff. And it's, I just sit there and listen to them. But how many times were those opportunities that I could have done that? And I missed because I was a chicken. You know, how many times? Well, and some of these times were obviously before we were really into where we are now. But, you know, you got to look back and say, I can't miss those opportunities anymore, because those all could have been great opportunities that I just...
Yeah. Was and you've also got to look at it as not letting the enemy get a foothold and attacking
you. And also, I really wish people would stop telling me these things, because I'm having nightmares.
Obviously, that's part of your purpose. Otherwise, people wouldn't be doing it, and God wouldn't be putting you in the position to be able to talk to them.
Okay. So, next question.
There's your assignment. Next question. Why don't you start doing that more?
Oh, gosh.
No, I ran out of time because of the kids. No, that's the testimony of how important it is to stay ready, mm-hmm. not worrying about getting ready, per se. So not trying to focus on, I've got to know X, Y, Z before I'll do X, Y, Z. It's, no, you've already been given what God has given you. You've already got the knowledge that you've got, so you can reach somebody with the knowledge that you have. Because look at it towards a non-believer, even if you know four Bible verses, how many do they know? How much of the book do they know? Probably not really any of it. So right. You know more. And like you just said, I mean, the case. Like, you've got your testimony for a reason to share it.
I was just about to say that. Like, it was crazy because... It wasn't the same exact thing, but it's similar to, like, trauma that I've been through. So, like, I shared that with her, and I told her how I got out of it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I told her, and that was a part of, like, a little piece of the testimony. Like, I told her how I survived, because she's like, there's some days I don't know. You know what I mean? What I'm getting at with that, mm-hmm. you know? And so it kind of circles back around where people are saying, why am I going through this? You know, and it's, well, you're going through it because A, there's sin in the world. You know, B, people are evil. And then C, I should have flipped around, because then I'm putting God last, and that's kind of bad. But you know what I'm saying? C, it's, you're surviving and you're doing all this so that you can turn around and tell people, you know, it's okay, and pull them out of the hole. And that was an exact example of that situation, because then I turned around and I said, you know, well, are you a Christian? She's, well, no. And I said, well, you know, I'll tell you what happened to me and, you know, where I went and what happened and how I got out of it years down the road. Let me tell you this now so you don't waste 8 years of your life, or, you know, 10 years of your life.
That's what mentoring is all about.
Yeah, I'm a mentor
the
now.
The speed of advancement without the pain. Just kidding. Without the pain of experience.
Just kidding, everybody. I'm not a mentor.
Yeah, I mean, you were.
Yeah, okay, I was just trying to.
Whenever you're ready to quit beating yourself up and knocking yourself down.
Oh, my gosh.
Everything,
it would be good. Next question.
That's the question. No. So, I mean, that was a good thing with being ready and being open. And that's something that more people need to do. I mean, we've all got a testimony, and that's the importance of keeping or getting your past out of the hands of the devil and owning your past. You don't have to be ashamed of your past. You're already forgiven of your past, and it's then becomes the testimony is your tool that you can use to reach people. That's one of the reasons why you've gone through all of the things that you've gone through. I mean,
I'm ready to stop going through it, though, because I'm getting kind of tired.
Well, until we get to glory, we're going to keep going through stuff. Man. That's just the nature of it since the fall of man, mm-hmm. unfortunately.
And I mean, a new problem would be good.
Who's to say how big the next one's going to be? So, you know, that's not exactly something you should want to hope for.
I'm not. Oh, my goodness gracious.
I think that's good. I'm ready to go see the kids. Because it's almost 8 o'clock.
Okay.
So, Sunday, do we have any... you said Sunday's a normal day?
Normal Sunday.
Sunday's a normal Sunday.
I'm going to be like your dad. Hold on, you let everybody know what you're going to preach on this Sunday. Give them a little sneak peek. I'm giving everybody country accents tonight.
That's your favorite thing. Well, real quick. So, yeah, this Sunday is... a normal Sunday, and then we've got the second annual for all of the copycats, if there were any.
Jared.
There's none. Nobody's copying an ugly Christmas sweater.
Oh, it's a bad
it's
idea.
It's on December 15th. And actually...
Oh.
That's going to be the end of the Jude series.
The 15th also is Kids Pajama Day, and they're going to be singing up here for a performance. The one song.
Was that supposed to be a surprise?
No.
Oh.
Because we need the parents of the kids to bring the kids early and don't show up at like 10:15.
Oh, well, the people need to quit showing up at 10:15 anyways. They need to show up at like 9:30.
Oh, my gosh.
Get here early. And invite people Sunday, obviously, if you're doing your homework. We're continuing Contend, episode 8.
Oh, my gosh.
Verses 22 to 23, and then... That Sunday, the 15th, we will be wrapping up the series with the final two verses,
wrapping
24
up, like a
and 25. And then after that, we have, on the 22nd, I've got something different to bring that actually will go with this series. So it'll be like an extra episode, bonus episode, if you will.
A
webinar.
Oh,
and then
I hate how you just said
the
that.
24th, we're doing the Christmas Eve candlelight service, 9 a.m.
Jared will be singing.
And 11. I will absolutely not. And 11 a.m. I guess we'll do two again. We need to start announcing that on Facebook. So we have those.
Okay.
And then the year is ending. And
chili cook-off.
I'm excited for that. Yeah,
your father's preaching on the 29th.
We're not supposed to tell anybody when people are preaching.
Why? What does it matter?
I don't know.
So I had a couple people, you know, just want to say, like, your dad is still preaching. You've just been in the middle of a series. Like, mm-hmm. He hasn't completely just ran away. Like, he's still preaching. You know, it's like you've said, you don't want to break a series up. It will still be you guys tag teaming. Preaching, he's absolutely not done with. He's just doesn't want to interrupt your series.
Yeah, I didn't want to break up the series.
Yeah.
It's hard to skip and then come back. It's weird.
Yeah. So that's it right there. And you're not doing, correct me if I'm wrong, you're not doing series every time you preach. Are you? You are? Yes?
Yeah, no. When we finish Jude, we're going into a different book of the Bible. So that doesn't mean so it's going to work differently. So with Jude, since it's short, I didn't want to break it up. The other one where we're going, it's going to take a very long time to go through, like a very long time. And I'm not expecting to not have him preach during that time. So that one won't matter like this one has mattered.
Okay.
That one will be different, but we're gonna jump into one of the Gospels. I'm not gonna tell you which until we get there, but we're gonna go into one of the Gospels and just start walking through.
I know which one it is. I think I know.
Well, don't say anything.
Okay.
Like you're dying to. I will cut this live stream off real quick.
Oh my gosh.
Sunday is the 22nd or the verse 22 to 23. Come early, stay late. I'm excited.
Don't
it's been a lot of fun.
Late. I want to go home. What do you mean? When the service is over, get out of the building.
And now I don't remember.
If you want to say hi, say hi. Say hi quickly.
I don't remember what it was.
Just kidding.
There was something I was going to say, but I've forgotten it. So whatever.
Also, share
the
events.
And prayer on Saturday.
Oh, my goodness.
At 5.
Yeah. And what can help us out too? People like, you know, how can we help? How can we help? You know, even the littlest things like sharing the events, you know.
Sharing everything. Getting on and putting likes and comments.
Right.
And not on the live streams as much as when we upload like the sermon to YouTube and then we share that to Facebook. Jump on there and watch it through or just let it play. And drop some comments in there, sharing it to your friends. Like,
we can't stress this enough. This is not an attention
really
thing for you.
But it's trying to get the gospel out, and that helps spread the gospel.
Right. Like you and I, I hate attention, and I know you've never been one. You can't stand attention. You know, so it's not, I don't want to get that twisted, because a lot of people, like with influencers, don't forget to hit like and subscribe, you know, and it's a to get them famous type of thing. That's not the deal. I mean, it's just trying to, we really want to build, we want to build people's relationships, but, you know, we can't, this is not to be taken the wrong way, we can't build without people.
Yeah.
So, you know, we can absolutely have a super strong, awesome, amazing church of 100 people. That's great.
None of them are lost.
Exactly.
And we're trying to reach the lost.
But to build and to reach more people, we're going to need more people's help. To get more people's help, we can't keep using the same 4 people to do things. It can't be you, me, Brooke, and Rodney, you know, doing all this stuff, especially, you know, God willing, especially if we get out to the 60 acres and we have a triple the size of a building. I cannot run every women's group. Like when your mom finally is like, I'm done, when which will probably never happen, but I'm saying when she's like, I'm tired of this, I'm done. I cannot run 4 different women's groups 4 times a week, you know what I mean? Plus do my job, plus do everything else. Like, I can't. So it's like we want to get the word out, to share, to bring people in, not just on the, you know, what's the word? Surface. Mm-hmm. On the surface side of things of, oh, we want to get popular. We want to be the biggest church, you know? That's never going to happen. You can't... No church should be the biggest church. It just should be hitting all the corners of the city. You know what I mean? Like you said before, we can't hold everybody in St. John's County. No. Reverb can't hold everybody. Colonial can't hold everybody. You know, great churches, great people. But we're not trying to take anybody from those churches, but we're just trying to build,
I'm
get
trying
the people
to reach
that are,
the lost.
Yeah.
And that's what we're
that don't have any home.
With asking people to share stuff. So like that, like even you asked how to contend the faith instead of trying to preach, jump on our YouTube videos and like and make comments and share them. Mm-hmm. And, you know, sharing our Facebook stuff, sharing our, like, just all of that and giving, like, time watching it. All of that is not to make us famous. It's just trying to get the message of the gospel out. That is literally a way to spread the gospel. And the reason it works that way is because that kicks the algorithm into gear. So basically, like, when a YouTube short goes out, the way it works is it puts it out to just a few people. If you have the notifications enabled, then you'll see it. Mm-hmm. If you don't click it, YouTube thinks nobody wants to watch it. They'll shut it down. If only a couple people watch it, it doesn't really do much. But if you get the notifications and like it's you see it the fastest with shorts. It would happen the same with our sermons, but
right.
Not to be rude, but really nobody's doing anything with our sermons when we upload them to YouTube. That's just not happening. So
Jordan,
it is what it is.
It.
But with the, yeah, you know what I'm saying. With the shorts, so the shorts pop up. Mm-hmm. If we had, there's 400 something seats in here. If mm-hmm. half of the people would immediately watch that and drop a comment and a like, you immediately have, just say,
like
200
I'll turn it
views.
On and I'll leave it running in the background.
Yeah, let it play twice. Because
yeah.
YouTube thinks, oh, they want to watch it again. It's important. And it's not, again, it's not trying to make us, I don't care about making us famous. It's about making Jesus famous. And I'm so tired of trying to clarify that. I'm done clarifying it. So whatever.
Okay.
So, but do you think, if you had 200 people the minute we posted something, mm-hmm. even 20 people, 50 people, 100 people, if all of them
all
immediately
the
watched it and clicked like mm-hmm. and shared it and dropped a comment, you have 100 likes, 100 views, and 100 comments, and YouTube's going to be like, wow, this is a really good video, and then it pushes it out. Same thing with TikTok. It's the same type of algorithm.
That's why TikTok dropped down this
yeah,
week.
Yeah, TikTok is also slowing down. But basically, when you jump on and you start making comments, the algorithm goes, oh, this looks important. People like this mm-hmm. content. Then they push it out to farther. Then if those people start liking it and commenting, then it goes farther. It doesn't just blast out everywhere off the rip.
I like
it
your
has
dad's
to start
Mother's
small.
Day video on TikTok.
Yeah, so like that. The Mother's Day video on TikTok has, last I checked, 1.2 million views on TikTok. That's mm-hmm. because
people
as
like,
it
bam,
went
bam,
out,
bam,
people
bam,
immediately
bam.
Started watching it, reposting it, adding it to their favorites, liking it, and making
arguing
comments
on
it.
It
still gets stuff today because it's still going out, because people still, when they view it, they still like it, they still share it, and they still comment on it. All of this stuff is dead in the water without the people of our church helping to share it. So if you don't even know where you want to serve in the church yet, or you're wondering how to contend for the faith or do whatever,
yep.
literally the easiest thing that takes zero time, well, not zero time, but takes zero energy from you in a couple minutes is just when we drop something on YouTube and Facebook and TikTok, is liking it, sharing it, and commenting on it every time. And that helps spread it, and that gets it further out. Again, whatever, I'm not going
to
say it again.
It's stuff like the family room stuff. We don't really hear about that. That's more just like for us to just, you
know. Yeah, and it'll get
and
there.
Guys. But no. I'm saying like the family, we don't care about like, oh, we post the family room, like share that. That's not.
No.
Because this is just chit-chat. It's not, but like a sermon.
Yeah.
That's what we care about the most is the sermons,
and
you know.
You spend a lot of time making the reels.
Well, the sermons, the reels of the sermons.
Yeah, I know, but I'm saying like with those, like, oh, they're really good, especially the ones lately, like with the music and everything.
The
and
music
you had
is
the
fire.
One of my prayer from the other week, and it's like, it was cool. Mm-hmm. And then YouTube blocked the one with music, and you had to put it up without music. And it was good, but it was a lot cooler with the music.
Be that cool.
But it's just the thing is that's the simplest thing you can do to help grow our church. Obviously, inviting people physically so they come into the building, but the same thing of the live videos are great. Obviously, all this engagement live is great, but in reality, the more important thing is for the stuff that's right. already posted.
You said you weren't going to say it again.
No, I was clear. I'm not clarifying.
I know.
The famous thing. I'm saying, so even like right now, when we finish this, if people started going to our reels or our sermons that's already on YouTube or TikTok and started liking it and watching it and commenting on it, that'll already kick those videos back into the algorithm and start pushing it back out again instead of it just being dead. So that's a very important thing to help the church grow because we're trying to reach the lost.
It also points to be mindful of what you are watching because you could be watching some bad stuff and helping it get further. So just
yeah, exactly. Well, it's easy. I mean, you look at
that in mind.
It's easy to scroll Facebook reels and look at a bunch of crap that means nothing. Or you could spend that time. You could spend that time looking at, and not just us, but other churches as well, going on their pages. You could start watching the gospel if you have a hard
Those
time with reading
I
the Bible.
You.
I'm just saying, like with our reels, think about it. With our reels, it's biblical content. So instead of watching whatever, and whatever, I'm not saying that's all you have to do, but instead of spending more time watching that stuff that does nothing to nourish your soul, think about it. So like you and other people, I know Julie's the same way. Like she has a hard time reading the Bible. So if you started consuming Christian content and like going on our reels and watching that more, you're getting fed more because your faith comes by hearing and hearing the word of God. So you're literally hearing the Bible, you're hearing preaching. That's helping to build your faith and your soul instead of just watching whatever under the sun. So technically, it's actually a much better thing to go and watch the biblical stuff.
Hey, I hope that message spoke to you today. I want to say thank you to everybody who is involved at Family Church and those who help support this ministry. If you would like to get more involved, you can click the link in the description or head to our website, familychurch.social. We would love to connect with you, and you can find all of our social media platforms on our website. Also, if this message spoke to you in any way today and you liked it, consider sharing it on your social media in any way that you would like so that we can help reach those far from God and return them to the arms of the Father. We want to see God work through you. We love you. Thanks again for listening. God bless you.